Alright, so in this video, we're going to talk about the sacral plexus. We already talked about the cervical plexus, we talked about the brachial plexus, we talked about the lumbar plexus. The last large plexus we have now is the sacral plexus. So let's go ahead and get started. So first, we're going to go through the topography. Just talk a little bit about which nerves feed into the sacral plexus. Then after that, we're going to make a scheme of the sacral plexus. And to make this as easy as possible to understand and remember, we're going to draw the general outline first. Then we're going to go ahead and divide the nerves into long branches and short branches and go through each nerve and a little bit of clinical importance related to those nerves. And at the end, there'll be a little quiz. So let's go ahead and get started with the topography. So here we see the spinal nerve within the vertebral canal. And here we see the spinal nerve leaving the intervertebral foramen. So there'll be one spinal nerve leaving on each side. They're paired. To be specific though, we're not really talking about the whole spinal nerve, right? We're actually talking about the anterior branch of the spinal nerve, because the anterior branch is what forms all the plexuses that we've talked about in this series of videos. Alright, so the sacral plexus is formed from the anterior branches of the spinal nerves L4, L5, S1, S2, S3, and S4. Alright, so this is a pretty big plexus. One of the main nerves that are coming from the sacral plexus is the sciatic nerve, and we'll talk a little bit about the clinical correlation with that. So let's go ahead and simplify this drawing. What I want you to do is to grab a piece of a paper and a pen, and I want you to draw the scheme with me. And once you do that, I promise you will remember this much, much easier. Alright, first off, we can start by drawing a line from L4 all the way down to S3, like you see here. What happens is, off from L4, there's going to be a division, an anterior division, that are going to traverse this way. On its way down, it will pick up a branch from L5, it will pick up a branch from S1, S2, and S3. Another thing that's going to happen is that from L4, same thing, another branch is going to emerge, but this one is going to be more posteriorly. And same thing, it will pick up a posterior branch from L5, S1, S2, and S3. These two nerves are called the tibial nerve and the common femoral nerve. So the tibial nerve comes from the anterior division of branches coming from L4 to S3, from the sacral plexus, and the common femoral nerve come from the posterior division of branches coming from L4 to S3, from the sacral plexus. However, those two nerves run together in a sheath, so they go together forming the sciatic nerve. It's referred to as the largest nerve we have in the body. It's about 2 centimeters in diameter. What happens is, the sciatic nerve is going to pass through the greater sciatic foramen, below the piriform muscle, and then pass between the muscles of the posterior thigh and descend distally towards the knee, posterior knee, the popliteal fossa. When it's at the posterior knee, it will split into 2 main branches, right? And this is where the sciatic nerve splits into the anterior division, also known as the tibial nerve, and the posterior division, also known as the common femoral nerve. They're both going to have a decent amount of cutaneous and motor supply. So for the tibial nerve travels with the posterior tibial artery and veins. They descend between the posterior muscles of the calf, reaches the sole via the malleolar canal, and then divides into the medial and the lateral plantar nerves. Alright, so the first branch that I want to mention here is the medial sural cutaneous nerve, which runs with the small saphenous vein. It lies very superficially under the skin, and then it joins the lateral sural cutaneous nerve from the common femoral nerve to form the sural nerve. The sural nerve is actually a type of somatosensory nerve, so it provides somatosensory innervation of the calf and the lateral side of the heel. Alright, other nerves that the tibial nerve is going to give off are muscular branches, which innervates the posterior muscles of the calf. It also gives off the medial plantar nerve. Now, this is a special nerve. Why is it special? It's special because the medial plantar nerve is both a cutaneous and a motor nerve. So, by motor fibers, it supplies the abductor hallucis muscle, flexor hallucis brevis, flexor digitorum brevis, and the first and the second lumbricals. The sensory fibers are gonna supply the medial part of the sole and form a common plantar digital nerves, which divides into 6 digital plantar nerves to supply the first, second, third, and half of the fourth toes. The tibial nerve is also going to give off a lateral plantar nerve, which travels with the lateral plantar artery and veins to the fifth toe and innervate the quadratus plantaris, which remember is a muscle that helps with flexion of the lateral four digits of the foot. Now, the lateral plantar nerve is eventually going to divide into 2 branches, a superficial branch, which gives off the proper plantar digital nerves for the fourth and fifth toe, and a deep branch, which travels to the interossei and the oblique head of the adductor hallucis to innervate the abductor digiti minimi, flexor digiti minimi brevis, interossei, adductor hallucis, and the lumbricals for the fourth and fifth toes. Alright, so that was the tibial nerve. Let's move on to the common femoral nerve. The common femoral nerve runs obliquely along the lateral side of the popliteal fossa, curves around the head of the fibula, and then it divides into 2 terminal branches, a superficial femoral nerve and the deep femoral nerve. Before we talk about these, there are some nerves that we should mention that has some important innervation for the local sensations here. One of the branches are the articular branches, which provide somatosensory innervation of the knee joint and the tibiofibular joint. There's the lateral sural cutaneous nerve, which provides somatosensory innervation for the lateral calf. And remember, it also joins the medial sural cutaneous nerve to form the sural nerve. Alright, so now, the superficial fibular nerve. This one will run between the fibula and the fibularis longus, and then continue between the fibular muscles. On its way down, it gives off muscular branches to innervate the fibular muscles, and then it penetrates the fascia, reaching the anterior surface, and then runs superficially on the dorsum of the foot. At this point, it gives off the medial dorsal cutaneous nerve, which splits into the dorsal digital nerves of the foot to innervate the medial side of the first toe, lateral side of the second toe, and the medial side of the third toe. And it gives off the intermediate dorsal cutaneous nerve, which splits into the dorsal digital nerves of the foot to innervate the lateral side of the third toe, the whole fourth toe, and the medial side of the fifth toe. Alright, we done the superficial fibular nerve. Let's talk about the deep fibular nerve. The deep fibular nerve will run along the anterior side of the interosseous membrane of the leg. Then it follows the anterior tibial artery and veins to travel under the extensor retinaculum, and then it emerges on the surface of the first interdigital space. It gives off the lateral dorsal digital nerves of the toe, which provide somatosensory innervation for the lateral side of the first toe, and a medial dorsal digital nerves of the toe, which provide somatosensory innervation of the medial side of the second toe. Alright, it's a large nerve. I advise y'all to draw it a couple of times. It helps. Now, there's actually one thing I forgot to mention about it. It's that the sciatic nerve has also muscular branches that innervate the posterior thigh, so the biceps femoris, semitendinosus, semimembranosus, and a part of the adductor magnus. And it has articular branches, which provide a partial somatosensory innervation of the hip joints. If there's a damage to the tibial nerve, usually it occurs in the malleolar canal, and can result from cut wounds, ankle fractures, and incorrectly applied plasters. It usually presents as impaired plantar flexion, which is an inability to stand on tiptoes, due to an impaired function of the triceps dura. And the ankle jerk reflex is usually absent due to the predominance of the unantagonized dorsal flexion of the tibialis anterior. The heel is the first part of the foot that touches the ground while walking. So this results in a syndrome called clubfoot or pes calcaneus. The fibular nerve, however, is covered only by skin where it lies near the head of the fibula. In this location, the nerve is most vulnerable to trauma and also compression from incorrectly applied casts. Dislocation and sprains of the knee can also cause harm to this nerve. And if there's a damage to the fibular nerve, the anterior muscles of the leg become impaired, resulting in a flapping foot and an inability to stand on the heels. Another thing that happens is that the arches of the foot gradually deteriorates due to the dysfunction of the fibularis longus. Okay, so that's the sciatic nerve, finally. The other nerve that's generally mentioned on the long branch category is the posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh. The posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh comes from S1. On its way down, it picks up a branch from S2 and it picks up a branch from S3. This one exits the pelvic cavity through the greater sciatic foramen, below the piriform muscle as well, and descends under the gluteus maximus to the posterior surface of the thigh to provide somatosensory innervation to the dorsal thigh. Then, more distally, it also supplies the skin over the popliteal fossa. Now, what happens is that it's going to give off the inferior clunial nerve, which provides somatosensory innervation to the distal part of the gluteus region, and the perineal branches, which provide somatosensory innervation to the perineal skin. Alright, so that was all the long branches, the branches that kind of extend a little further from the sacral plexus. Now, let's go over and do the nerves that are considered short, the short branches. The short branches, the first one that we're going to mention, is called the pudendal nerve. The pudendal nerve is going to come from S2, and on its way is going to pick up a branch from S3, as well as a branch from S4. The pudendal nerve runs through the infrapiriform foramen with the internal pudendal artery and veins. Then it turns around the ischial spine into the lesser sciatic foramen, enters the ischioanal fossa, and passes inside the pudendal canal to reach the external genital organs. So essentially, this one will end up in the genital organs. It will terminate as either the dorsal nerve of the penis or the dorsal nerve of the clitoris to supply the skin of the penis or clitoris. There are three main side branches that we should be aware of for this nerve. The first one is the inferior rectal branches, which innervate the external anal sphincter and provide somatosensory innervation to the skin around the intergluteal crest. The second ones are the perineal nerves, which supplies all the muscles of the perineum, and they also supply the skin of the perineum and terminates as the posterior scrotal nerves for men or the posterior labial nerves for female to supply the skin of the external genitals. The third nerve that we should be aware of is the anococcygeal nerve, which supplies the skin in the region of the coccygeal bone. Alright, so that was the perineal nerves. Other nerves we have are so-called muscular nerves. So we're going to have nerves coming off the L5, S1 and S2 that are going to supply the obturator internus and the superior gemellus muscles. So nerve of the obturator internus and superior gemellus muscles. Why is it important? Because these are also deep muscles. They provide lateral rotation of the hip or external rotation of the hip. Okay, so that's going to be this nerve. Now, there's going to be another one. Coming off S1 and S2 is a nerve for the piriformis muscle, which is also a deep muscle, giving external rotation at the hip joints. Alright, the last two nerves are thankfully easy ones too. They're called the superior gluteal nerve and the inferior gluteal nerve. The superior gluteal nerve comes from the anterior branches of L4 L5, and S1. And this one is going to run through the suprapiriform foramen to innervate the gluteus medius, gluteus minimus, and the tensor fasciae lata. And these are important muscles. They're abductors. So if there's a damage or compression of the superior gluteal nerve, usually it leads to impairment in abduction of the hip joint. Walking and standing on one foot can become difficult, and patients develop a duck-like gait. To prove this, you can check for Trendelenburg's sign. It's usually positive in damage to the superior gluteal nerve. It is demonstrated by asking the patient to stand on the affected leg. The unsupported side of the pelvis will drop lower than the side the patient is standing on. The other one is the inferior gluteal nerve, and this one is going to come from the anterior branches of L5, S1, and S2. This one will run through the infrapiriform foramen to innervate the gluteus maximus. Now, gluteus maximus is important because it provides two functions. One function is that it's going to play a role within extension at the hip joint, and it's also going to play a role within external rotation at the hip. So a paresis of the inferior gluteal nerve usually result from impaired function of the gluteus maximus, limiting the extension at the hip joint, and this usually causes it to be difficult to walk upstairs. Alright, so that really sums up the sacral plexus. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you all an easy quiz. I'm going to change all the labels to numbers and put the names in a table. Then I'm going to make all the names disappear. And can you, from the beginning, tell me what is the name of number 1? What is the name of number 2? What does number 3 supply, and what does number 4 supply? If you can do that, then you've got a good grasp of this topic. There you have it, my friends. Thank you so much for watching another one of my videos. If you enjoyed, learned something from it, please remember to like, comment your favorite moment, subscribe, turn on those notifications. If you're looking for other ways to support, go ahead and check the link in the description box. See you next time. Peace.